Welcome to Crossroads Podcast, an SIBKL production.
Alrighty, escapism and avoidance. Yeah. But before we even get into if it's, is it right or wrong, what even is it? I think this is, we all know what escape is. We know what an ism is.
What is it?
What is escapism? Okay, I'm going to look to the two people that studied psychology.
How would you conceptually define it?
Yeah, I mean, it still boils down to avoidance, right? Because you're just removing yourself from whatever it is that you are trying to get away from, right? And at least, okay, I'm not going to give you like the dictionary definition, but maybe from my experience on seeing some of maybe my patients or my clients that do go into escapism, right? It is sometimes when you escape, you might not be able, you know, like in an escape room, it gets difficult to then go back to your reality. Or that form of escapism almost kind of like changes a part of who you are. Yeah. Whereas avoidance, again, I'm not like a researcher or anything, okay? But like avoidance is, it's somehow still maybe like at the back of your mind, right? And then you can come back to it. Yeah.
Actually, so that's quite cool. But you see how sometimes the escapism actually changes your reality or how you view reality.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking in terms of like if I watch a horror movie or a ghost show and then like these kind of ghosts. Okay. Pennywise doesn't exist. Pennywise is the clown. The scary clown, okay. By the way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it doesn't exist.
Okay.
But now that also, you think. right. Like, it doesn't exist, but now that I watch it, it kind of changes my view on reality. Because now I'm scared of clowns.
Sheesh. Okay.
Am I on the right track or am I just waffling?
No. I think it's completely, completely good. Like, in my head now, I'm just thinking of Inside Out. Inside Out 2. Where your memories forms your beliefs.
Yeah.
Your beliefs shape who you are.
I'm a good person.
Yeah.
I'm not good enough.
I think it's I watched it.
Oh, you watched it?
Yeah, I watched it.
In Singapore?
I'm not good enough.
No, here.
Oh.
Yeah, I think it's more than the memories itself because memories are generated through your experiences, right? So that experience of putting yourself in that escaped world is essentially what then builds into your core beliefs and builds into what you believe about the world, others, and yourself. Yeah.
That's pretty cool. That's why people like they get into it. Like, let's say, okay, I want to caveat this before we continue. Not every person in gaming, watching movie, watch anime, do cosplay is a crazy escapist. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. No.
Yes.
We just want to caveat that.
Yes.
Before we continue, okay.
Correct.
Some of it is just fun, good fun. Well,
I guess we're just exploring how far is too far.
Yeah, we're just exploring that. Okay? But yeah, just want to put that there. Okay?
Yeah.
That huge disclaimer. But yeah, coming back to it is that's why they come back is the experience they feel in that virtual world.
Mm-hmm.
How much have you, or how many clients have you spoken to that have this thing where they, like, what is the common, I think the first question I want to ask is, what is the common reason for escapism?
That's a good question. And, well, again, I think I have to go back to avoidance first because, at least in my mind, escapism is, like, avoidance that's too long and, like, prolonged avoidance.
So avoidance is just, like, before escapism, is it?
I guess you can put it that way. For the sake of this discussion, let's just term it like that.
Yeah.
Right? So, a lot of times, what is it that people want to avoid? It comes down to what makes you uncomfortable. What maybe reveals something about either yourself or others that you don't like, right? Or pain. A lot of emotions. You not wanting to face your emotions. It can be sadness. It can be anger. Actually, right, sometimes even happiness. Because people feel, right, like, oh, if I'm happy for too long, like, sadness is bound to be at the corner. Kind of thing.
That's so sad.
Yeah.
Inside Out 3.
It's actually so common. So a lot of people who are stuck in depression, right, they'll go, but if I come out of depression, then if I become happy again, then sadness will just eventually find its way back. Yeah, so that's actually super common for people who struggle with depression.
That's sad. That's like...
Yeah.
Oh, man. Like, that's kind of heavy.
Yeah, that was kind of heavy.
But avoidance, that's essentially when something makes you uncomfortable or you don't want to face it.
So you don't want to face it.
Yeah.
Like now, what is the... escapism, you would say it's just you already mentioned it, an escape from reality, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have mentioned how it's about avoiding like a lot of our feelings.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. But other than feelings, what are some real life like examples you have? Like what, like has anyone come in to get like, oh, because lack of a better example, I mean the easiest one is like, I don't want to study, I just want to play game.
Yeah.
Is that escapism or is it just a kid?
No, I think it is. Because they're avoiding what responsibilities they might have. The only responsibilities they have at that age to look into something else that they to escape that reality of the responsibility they're put in.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is the case that could be expounded to people of other age groups as well.
Yeah.
If you're not talking about just youth, right?
Games.
Yeah. Whether it is things to do with work, or there's things to do like with just relationships.
Super going into a series.
Yeah.
Like that's a form of
like binge
watching. Yeah.
Yeah, like binge watching.
Yeah. And the other thing I picked up also from what Em was sharing was that, because she mentioned that prolonged avoidance leads to escapism. Mm. So the train of thought I'm thinking of is, are we all prone to avoidance?
Yeah, I mean, if you have emotions,
I mean, we all avoid in a way, like like we, the only thing I can think of avoiding is confrontation. But that's so crazy. Like we avoid facing. I think a lot of guys do this. They avoid facing emotion.
Yeah,
they avoid facing. Actually, some form of confrontation, like if your girlfriend like comes at you, like beats you up, or like scold you, right? And then you just go like, I'd rather be shooting up some guys online than be receiving this. This is like nothing personal, but yeah. So that's avoidance.
Yeah, I think kind of building on to Ryan's point, right?
Yeah.
So using your example is still responsibility. Like in relationships, there's responsibility. So a lot of times avoidance is also you wanting to not face a certain consequence, right? And a lot of times is that paralysis of, oh, I have to take action or I have to make a decision or a choice and I want to delay it, right?
Yeah.
So avoidance is a form of delaying. But every time you delay something, there's bound to be a reaction to it as well.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, confrontation is definitely one thing that people want to avoid as well.
So there is, I mean, in the first episode, we talked about addiction a little bit, but we talked about it in a more coping mechanism way, right? Okay. But in a term of escapism and avoidance, like how does, because what we're talking about is like, you can be addicted to this stuff. Like, for example, this online persona you have.
Mm-hmm.
You could be just so living in this virtual reality. Like, do you have any experience with that? With someone that they just can't get their mind off virtual reality and they don't even have a sense of reality anymore?
Yeah.
Face with anyone like that? Or?
Yeah, I think for me, I don't really have experience with really like the gaming, you know, in a metaverse kind, but just that persona that they built for themselves. Like, I think online relationships is a very common one, right? And then they, but they're so, that's just not what is achievable in their real life, right? So because it's a very, you get very reinforced in your mind because the person on the other end, you won't escape into something that doesn't reward you in a certain way.
Reward you?
Yes. Okay. Like you gain something.
Yeah, because
from
some
it.
People, right, when like on in real life,
mm-hmm.
they're like a nobody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But when they get into game,
yeah.
they're a hero. Correct. Or like I mentioned the cosplay one at the start.
Yeah.
Like, wow, I cannot explain to you the joy on these people's faces when you say, hey, can I take a picture?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, not just the joy, but you can see the inner, not like they are very proudful, but they are like, whoa, someone has validated my effort.
I think validation is the big thing.
Yeah.
Because essentially, a lot of people want to find a place to belong, right? Because they don't find a place in the real world to belong. They have to outsource or like look elsewhere, right? And if it's online or wherever, gaming world or anime world, there's already that simple thing that binds people together, right? So it breaks down some barriers of finding some common ground. Yeah.
So it's not even, I mean, you don't even need to talk about online. You can just talk about like different friend groups, right? Where you have a person, we have this. We are one way outside, we're one way at home, we're one way in church, we're one way in school, one way at work. And that's some sort, but that's real reality, lah. Mm-hmm, but that's not who you actually are inside.
Yeah.
You run away. But what are people actually running away from?
Well, like pain. I mean, again, there's a lot of things to run away from. If you really think about it, I bring back to why people run away is it is also a form of coping, right?
Yeah.
And you're grasping at something. So you need to understand why is it that people run away to these things. Like I mentioned earlier, they're getting something.
Mm.
So different people will gain different things, whether it's a sense of belonging, whether it's a sense of achievement, whether it's validation, accomplishment, or just being...
accepted. Like,
acceptance. Yeah, acceptance is a really big one. Yeah.
So that... Sorry, Ryan, do you want to say anything?
Yeah, I think going back to Pastor Sean's question on... what are people running away of? I'm quite big on my belief in this, but I feel a lot of times people are running away from themselves or running away from being alone. Because there is it's just how it has been ingrained into culture that silence is scary. Being silent and being alone is scary.
Yeah.
That's why sometimes people cannot go about their day without listening to music. People cannot go about their day without having something occupy their minds.
Listening to a podcast.
I guess so.
And listen to a podcast to sleep.
Good night, darling.
Actually, that's really true.
Yeah.
Because when you are left, you know, blank and, you know, just exiting within your own thoughts.
Yeah.
It's very confronting. It's very uncomfortable.
Like that self-awareness is quite, like you said, confronting. It's very uncomfortable. It's very, actually self-awareness is huge.
Yeah.
Can you in 1 minute explain what that is?
Basically, self-awareness comes down to your perception of yourself.
Yeah.
Right? And with your perception of yourself, it doesn't come only from within.
Yeah.
You actually feed off, if you want to look at you can look at the biology, the psychology, and your
social neurology.
And your social environment. Right? So I think even having self-awareness is not just, oh, who do I think I am? You're having to interpret all these past experiences combined with the person that you want to be, right? Versus the person that you actually are right now, right? So not constantly occupying your mind, you're being confronted with these things, right? And being with yourself and that overwhelming feeling of I have to think my own thoughts, generating my own thoughts. And it's very scary when you don't actually know who you are.
Ooh.
And I think that a lot of people don't know who they are.
Yeah.
I think there's this one thing I read. I did my homework as well. have to, right? Where like why people do fall into like avoidance or escapism is when they are their true self and who they want to be, or let's say their ideal self. That's the word.
Yep.
Their true self and their ideal self is so far apart.
Yeah, there's a dissonance.
That the dissonance is too crazy. Oh, you, I can see the psych degree coming out.
Amazing.
Like there's a dissonance between their true self, their real self, and their ideal self that like they can't handle the burden or the disappointment of that. That's why they find something that feeds them.
Yeah, I think it's easier in that sense to just attach yourself to something that's already existing. Right? And sometimes it's kind of like power in number sort of thing where, or rather society just promotes like, you know, oh, you cannot eat alone. Like, you can't do this. Mm. It's not that you can't, you know, but you're convinced of that. Yep. Right? So, yeah, these are the things that
Yeah, like you, like if you eat, you go out by yourself, you look weird, you feel weird. Mm-hmm. And
you're self-conscious, right?
Yeah, you're self-conscious. Yeah.
And it's so uncomfortable to be self-conscious. Yeah, I guess play a video.
Yeah. I mean, I do that also. I do that also.
Same.
But I guess it's just the fact that it's easier to dive into all this than to dive into your own mind.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's true.
Heavy. You know what? We've talked about escapism, but I think what would you say to someone that's experiencing this? I think the clinical psychologist has to take this. That one is experiencing this, or like I know a friend that is going through this. Like this person is deep into this stuff.
Mm.
He's deep into living a separate life. Like what would you say to them? Like how would you advise them or comfort them?
Right. I think the first thing is they might not see that it's an issue and nobody likes being told that they're wrong.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right. So I think it has to come from a very empathetic place of what got them there to the first place. I think it's a huge epidemic in like in Japan, right? Like there's all these gaming and then they're like really sucked into it.
Mm.
And for them, it's because there's a lot of societal pressure on males to like perform or to achieve, right? So I think there's no one answer. I can't say like, oh, this is it, right? But there are a few key things that I think to bring it from a spiritual perspective as well that doesn't run far from psychology, which is people need a place to belong, acceptance. Attachment is actually a very big one. When people have attachment issues, right, they tend to be a bit more impulsive in fight. Not to say impulsive. It's easier for them to latch on other things. So because of the insecurities, right? So I think to meet at that person, I think being something consistent is important because like what's so enticing about a virtual reality or virtual world? It's always going to be there.
Yeah.
24/7.
And you can kind of predict the...
Yeah, exactly. So being constantly there and, you know, showing your love and acceptance in a way, right? Yeah. That's going to be really important.
Do you join them in it?
Well,
because so where I'm getting at with this is, I think it's in Corinthians when Paul says, if he's a Jew, I will be a Jew with them.
Okay, yeah.
When if he's poor in spirit, I'll be in poor in spirit with them.
Okay.
So essentially, Paul is saying, like, where this person is at, I will be at also with them, so that we can speak from a similar perspective, speak from a same scale. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that?
I think, I mean, in that context, it's not in every situation. Because like, if someone's in sin, you don't go down to the level of sin and bring that out of it. But I feel like all these things are kind of, like gaming is actually neutral.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, there's of course bad games out there, but gaming, cosplay, these things are neutral, but okay, let's be realistic. Cosplay is not very neutral. It's highly sexualized. I'll say it from here, from what I see, right? But it is understanding the world that they are in and not just condemning it. And not just going, oh, what you're doing is bad. What you're doing is weird. Like, you can't, like, don't write them off
you'll
so fast.
Them,
yeah, you'll lose them. Yeah. And there's, and like, if you're a leader or if you're a caring friend.
Yeah.
You don't even need to be a leader. Or it's just a caring friend. Like, don't write these things off. They'll go like, oh, you're a gamer, what a weirdo.
Yeah.
Or you're in cosplay, wow, you are weird. I think, I mean, I am, what's the word? I've been guilty of that, right? Like, having some preconceived notions about certain things. But that's if you really want to reach out to someone to crossroads them, and if they're in a crossroads of thinking about something, right? And how you want to lead them back to Jesus, it's really about understanding the world that they're in.
Yeah.
And not just that, but understanding about where they come from or what got them there in the first place.
Like,
like Romans 12, like,
yeah.
Be in the world but not of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly that.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, if you are listening to this and you know you or you know someone that is going through what we're talking about, in any form of avoidance, hey, speak to them. Or if you are going through it, speak to one of your leaders, speak to one of your pastors. And hey, we are, as we heard, that really what we just want is, I got from Emily, is what we really want is community, what we want to be a part of something. And she's my sister. Calling Emily is a bit weird. But what we really want to be is a part of something.
Yeah.
And hey, church is always open for you.
Yeah.
We are always open for you to be a part of us. And we're going to close this segment for now, but we want to resume after this. So hey, stay tuned for the next episode.
Thank you for tuning in. If you enjoyed this episode, subscribe for more Crossroads content. Look forward to new episodes every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. If you need to speak to a pastor, or if you're looking for a church to call home, come visit SIBKL.